Basically, today we are going to start with the hacking of iOS application. Basically, it's not easy. First, you need to understand the basics of iOS. So, I am Danish Inamdar from CDAC Hyderabad. So, I will be presenting on this. So, let's start with the presentation. First, we go with the introduction of the iOS. So, iOS basically refers to iPhone OS. It was developed in 2007. So it, for iPhone and I touchpads and all. So it's basically only operating system that only works for the Apple hardware and only related to the Apple's operating system. It's not open source, so it's like bit complex, and it's we can say it's more secure compared to Android. So basically, we can move ahead. So basically, if we see the architecture of iOS, it is basically based on the Mac OS X. OS X is the version of Mac that is basically the MacBook or the desktop version of Mac. So basically, in that is related to it. So it is based on a Unix based operating system. So if we see the architecture, it is a layered architecture. So basically, the Unix consists of the Unix Darwin at the core level. Below that is the graphics, and above that is the application layer, and on top of there is a user interface, that is the Aqua layer for the Mac OS. And there are system interfaces or the framework that helps to interact within the within the OS. You can see the diagram. This is self-explanatory and will be more helpful for you all to understand. So basically, the application layer is the touch layer that consists of the UI kit framework, map kit, and notifications, message, and all whatever applications we are using that are basically part of the Cocoa Touch. So these are based on the framework that are being used. And below that, there is a media layer. Media layer basically refers to the audio, video, whatever connections we hear or we are right now, what you are seeing, that is basically because of interaction of the media layer. And basically, it consists of the frameworks like Core Graphics, iPhone Audio, Media Player frameworks, Core Audio. These are the basic frameworks that are related to the media. And below that is the core services. The core services basically are the foundation on which the above layers are built. So it consists of the libraries like the OpenCL, system configurations, disk attributions, like how the disk distribution is done, that can be seen. And the directory services and all. So of all the StoreKit framework, foundation framework and all. And below there is a kernel and the device driver. So basically, when you're interacting, mostly Apple does not allow normal devices to connect to it. Only like Apple devices can connect to the iPhone or the MacBook. So the device driver support is existing only for the Apple hardware and software. So it's like a bit closed environment. So yeah, so we can go ahead and we can see here the iOS architecture too. So basically, this is more self-explanatory. Basically, we have a hardware, above that there is operating system, and above that there is application. So these three things interact with each other. As I have said you, like Core OS basically has the main basic features like the Bluetooth, security services, and authentication and all. Above that comes the core services that consist of the address, core, and all the data locations and whatever, like GPS and all, whatever you're using. Above that comes the audio, and then comes the Cocoa Touch. So it's like self-explanatory. Diagram is quite self-explanatory. So we'll move ahead. So basically, for iOS applications, like for Android, we have APK files. Similarly, for iOS, we have IPA. IPA basically refers to iPhone Application Archive. So it's a zipped file. So mostly the iOS applications are developed in Objective-C and Swift. So the integrated development environment used for iOS application is basically Xcode. Like for Android, we have Android Studio. Similarly, we have your Xcode. So for development, basically Xcode is most usually by the Apple developers or the iPhone for developing the applications. Then you can see that iOS based on the MVC. MVC refers to the Modern View Controller. So what happens is here view is the UI part and model is the data collection, and controller helps to interact between the view and model. So why the MVC is used? So it is using the reason for using model, view, and controller is that separate, it's more extensible, easy to use, and like processing is quite faster, and there is separation in the application. Like you can separate the business logic, user interface logic, and the input logic. So this all are separate, and it's a bit easy for like to perform actions using these three. When these three interact, then the like it's extensible and reliable to integrate into the framework or application you are making. So comparatively, it is extensible and faster compared to other models. So like in previous session, you heard about malware and all. So what happens is iOS is quite secure compared to it. What happens, it checks for security at boot level also. So even if someone tries to infect a file, it won't enter the boot ROM or the grep like internal paths. So what happens is while the application while the OS loads at the boot level, it checks for the CA. CA basically refers to certifying authority. So it checks for the root certifying authority. After that, it checks for the user UID. UID basically refers to user ID, and the GID refers to the group ID. So it checks these two things: group user ID, group ID, and root certifying authority. After that, the boot starts, and then it goes to the lower level bootloader. Then again, a verification happens with the Apple for the root certifying authority. So these certificates are genuine certificates of the Apple. So it's not easy to manipulate or change the certificates. So it verifies the certificate. After the lower level boot level verification is done, it moves to the iBoot. So iBoot again verifies if it is properly signed by Apple. Once it's verified, then only the kernel loads. And at the kernel level, again, there is a verification of the signature. After that, what happens is there is a, these are the kernel level signature checks. Again, when the app is loading, there is a signature check of the application. So when a developer signs, releases an application on App Store, he has to sign it. So that's, that signature is again checked, that if it is a genuine and valid signature, then only the app will load. And when the app loads, the UDID, like every application that is getting installed or on iOS or iPhone, it's a UDID, installed based on the UDID. UDID is the unique device identification that identifies the device device on which the application is being installed. So like if the UDID matches, then only, so it's not directly possible to install malicious application on phone. So you need to have logged in into the App Store properly, then only. So it's a bit secure compared to Android. So like fake signature vulnerabilities are not that much in iOS. And then you can understand that when you install an application, there is a sandboxing. Like every application has its own environment. They cannot interact with one another unless required or the as per the user function application functionality. And even there is a data protection at the keychain level. So when the data gets stored in for application in the iPhones, it is bit encrypted format. So it's not easy to manipulate, and data gets stored in encrypted bit format as written over here. So you can go, we can move ahead with the next slide. Yeah, so iOS file system. So like what the file system, when you install an application on an iPhone, you get this kind of file system set up on when you install an application from App Store. These are the files that are created on the user's phone. This is the myapp.app. Then are the documents that are the part of the application. Then there are the libraries. Then there is the temporary folders, or like some temporary data that will be available only during, after you log out, this temporary data gets wiped out. So similarly, like you synchronize your, in some application, you synchronize your data to the cloud. So whatever data is synchronized to the cloud, that will appear under the iCloud container. So the based on the after logging into the Apple account and the iCloud synchronization done, you can view the data from the app using the iCloud container feature. Yeah. So like here, I have given in detail about the each file system. Like app bundle contains the app and its resources. Documents are the user-generated data content, and then libraries are the custom data files. So libraries are basically getting installed based on the version of the iPhone, like what is the exact support. Like in Android, we have x86. Similarly, here we have the hardware versions. Based on the hardware versions, the libraries will be getting installed on the iPhone, like which depends on the, like iPhone 6, you are using libraries will be different. and the current versions iPhones, like it will be different for 11 and all that is there. And temporary folders are created after login, as I said, based off the login you can check. Yeah, so iOS application basics. So basically we have discussed that it is zip format, and using Xcode we develop the integrated framework to develop the application using the language Swift or Objective-C. Then it is compiled, then it is signed using Apple developer account, and by default it is secure as no self-signed certificates are allowed in the in the iOS environment. And for installing in a staging environment, you required Xcode plus the unique device identification. So when you go to the app store, when you connect your device to the system and you log in into the iTunes, you can get the UDID. So if you are interested in trying on a developing, you need a MacBook. So it's a bit dependent that some things will not work on the Windows for iOS. You require a MacBook and proper Apple devices to perform certain development kind of things. Jailbreaking. So what is jailbreaking basically? So what happens is like we have a OWASP top 10, like we have for web application and Android. Similarly, it's like mobile OWASP top 10. It's same for both Android and iOS. So basically it includes like features like various like insecure authentication is there, like improper platform usage, insecure local storage. So insecure local storage basically refers to how data is stored inside a phone. Like when you log in into certain application like a Gmail or some other application, you are logging into your iPhone, the data gets stored on the device. But in a general case, user cannot retrieve data, like he cannot access the login password and username he has entered. It gets stored into the internal file system. So for accessing the internal file system, you need to jailbreak your device. So jailbreak is like a privilege escalation as mentioned over here. Once you jailbreak, the jailbreak technique is different for different versions of iPhones, like based on the iOS versions. Like iOS 10 is different. For iOS 13, it's different. Like iOS 13, we use Chimbra and all, and Checkrain. These are the different kind of jailbreak techniques you need to try in order to view the internal storage and like have a root access to your device. Other than having root access, you can customize your device. Once the device is customized, you can get more access. Like you can modify the UI, whatever the look you are seeing, you can customize the interface. Then you can unlock the carrier. Basically, carrier unlocking refers to increase the bandwidth of the mobile. Once you increase the bandwidth, you can connect to the other networks. Like it is quite complex. You need to have a custom IPSW. Like in Android, we have a custom ROMs. Similarly, in iPhones, iOS, we have a IPSW. So you need to have a signed beta version of IPSW. Then only you can try and do perform these things. Yeah, we'll move to the next slide. Yeah, so how to a jailbreak is possible. So once you jailbreak, the no more the Apple will provide support for your device. It's like your responsibility. You have to take care of your device while jailbreaking. So it's only for learning purpose. So yeah, to jailbreak your device, you need to visit the link Can I Jailbreak? This provides details based on the version. So like based on the iOS operating system version, you can try the techniques. You can visit this link if you're interested to jailbreak, and then you can look for the techniques that are given, and based on the iOS version, you can try to jailbreak. So like, yeah, jailbreaking procedure. So the jailbreaking procedure is like quite complex, and it can further, it's divided into two types, like tethered jailbreak and untethered jailbreak. Tethered jailbreak needs you to connect to the device, and when you switch off the device, the jailbreak is gone. So it's like a temporary jailbreak. It's not a proper jailbreak. So for a proper permanent jailbreak, that is the untethered jailbreak. Yeah. So even if you switch on or switch off the mobile, still the jailbreak is there. So basically, for that there are different techniques. So like for tethered jailbreak, what happens is like it's a temporary jailbreak. Only during the phone is switched on, then only it works. So you need to take care that your phone does not get switched off. You have to take care it's always charged. So like in some cases, in some versions of iOS, only tethered jailbreak works. So if you are not properly jailbreaking, then the tethered will. So mostly the untethered jailbreak is a bit complex, but it helps you in longer run. You have to switch off and switch on your mobile. Then also the techniques, whatever things you have done, it will be still there on their device for the research purpose. So based on the jailbreak technique, like in a normal device, we have only App Store for installing application. So if you have to install a third party app, it's not possible directly. Once you jailbreak, you have a third party App Store that is called Cydia. So once you get the third party App Store, you can install and customize. So basically for this, based on the jailbreaking technique, you get either Cydia or Celio. So like in Cydia, you have alternating customized things. Like if you install using like Electra, Uncover and Phoenix, then this is available in Cydia. And if you are using Celio for jailbreak, then it is comes with the Chimera iOS jailbreak. Yeah. So here also you have a support for Cydia and Celio. So based on the technique you're using, the app stores will be a third party app. These are the third party app store or plugins that will be available for you. Yeah. So installing iOS applications. So even installing an iOS application is a bit complex. So if you are using a Windows operating system, there are only two ways you can install. That also only some staging applications will work with the iPhone box. And if you have a iTunes old version, then also you can try to install an application. So like in current version of iTunes, I think they have removed that support. So only with Passion Fruit is there. That also you can try for Windows. But Mac, there are a lot of tools like Xcode is there, the development framework Xcode. Then there is an App Store. Then you can through command line terminal, you can install the iOS deploy tool. And other than that, once you jailbreak, the Cydia impactor is there. Using that also, you can install the applications. Yeah. So we will move ahead with the lab. So like is my screen visible? Invisible to you? I'll continue. Okay, fine. Okay, someone has a question like how CA checks acquired while booting. So basically it's like the boot certifying authority that is getting installed. Like when the device is being manufactured, that CA is being set up on that. So there is a hash value or an integrity check that it's not manipulated. So if the without internet connection, okay. So CA checks are done without internet. Yeah, because it's matching the hashing. Without internet connection also the certifying authority checks are done because that is stored on the device itself. The rooted certificates are done on the device itself. So it just checks that the hash value. If the hash value matches, then only it moves ahead. So like there is a CA defined for them, that hash value matches, then that it will work. It's not related to internet connection. It's basically the hash value. It checks with the hash value. Hope I have answered your question. I will move ahead with the lab manuals. Yeah. So basically I created some like manual. So you can see here, like first, how to it's not possible to sign a production ready application on iOS. But like if you are interested in trying something on your own, you can try to using an iOS app channel. This tool you can install on a MacBook. You require a MacBook for this. So once you have a MacBook, you can install this tool. And further, I am here using a application called iGoat. So iGoat is the application developed by one of our open source resources, Swaroop. So you can use that application if you are interested in learning. So iGoat is the thing you need to install. So here I have done that same thing. So in that I have taken that file then I have created a developer account. You need to create an Apple developer account. Once you have integrated a certificate in the Xcode development framework, you can like set up this whole thing, and then you have to select the IPA file, the iGoat IPA file. So basically, I am using a free version of free version of this developer kit. So when you sign using a free version, it is only active for 1 week. So for like personal use, you can use that. Like 7 days, you get the application signed, and after the 7 days, the application won't work on the device. So it's like this for testing purpose. So we can see how secure is the iOS. Even the signing procedure is a bit complex, and you can have you need to have a proper developer account, then you have to like buy that thing like for free. It's valid for 7 days. You can install on a personal device using the UDID and all. Yeah, so one other method, if you don't have a MacBook, one other method is there, that is basically using the iPhone box. So see, I'm trying to maximize my screen. So when I are you able to see? This is the tool that gets installed on the Windows. Once the tool is getting installed, okay, now it's not, I think it's visible properly. Okay. Yeah, so you can see that we need to select the application. We need to connect the device. Like we have to connect the device here. See, you can see that my name is appearing, that my phone is connected to the system. Once it's connected, you have to select the install app thing. Once you select and then click, it gets installed on the application. So another tool, you have to do a static analysis. So if you don't have MacBook, then also you can install on a Linux or Ubuntu system or a Kali. Then you can install a tool called MobSF. So you can install using MobSF. You have to manually set up this tool. Otherwise, what you can do is you can use a virtual machine called MobElixir. So in that, you have a MobSF installed. So if the MobSF is already installed in a virtual machine, then what you have to do is just start the server. Yeah, you have to start the server. Once the server is started, like sudo mobsf start, so it gets visible. So you have to visit this link, the local 8000 port. Then you have to like what I have to do is like so see, you will get a screen of mobsf like that on the browser. You have to enter the port 8000 and localhost. Then you have to select the IPA file. And once you set up that select that IPA file, you have to click on open and wait for some time till the analysis is done. Once the analysis is done, you can see here like there is complete information about the application. So it will try to analyze, do the static analysis, and give you a report and form. And you can like try to analyze the report, what is there here. Like you can see there is a various NS transport security vulnerability. So basically NS app transport security vulnerability refers to like insecure communications over HTTP. If iOS application, if it allows NS app transport flag set to true, so NS arbitrary load flag is set to true, then communication over HTTP is possible. So that should be restricted in the application. So you need to recommend a developer to disable this kind of flags in the application. So this is the thing, and other than that, other issues also gets a static analysis can be done using this. So you can download a complete report if you have this tool, and like basic checks you can do using this. And other than this, there is one more way. Like if you want to check the logs in what happens in like there is a banking application. So what happens is like if it is not properly developed by a developer, in case he forgets to disable logs. So like every applications has a logs ability to send logs. So while developing application, it's recommended that in production ready application, logs needs to be disabled. So in case if application developer forgets to disable the logging functionality in the application, then like I have shown here, you are entering your banking details, this card number, the CVV and the PIN. And after you enter the details, it is getting stored on the device. So like what happens is, sorry. One problem with the screen. So it's properly visible. Yeah, so what happens is you have a tool called console. Once you use this tool called console, in open that application and you need to select the device and you type CVV and you can see in the device log the CVV getting stored. So for a secure application, you need to disable logs, and you can verify this using the IGO. This application basically IGO. So like any application you want to test, you have to do that thing and try username and password, then check that logs in the phone. So this you can check this kind of vulnerability for iOS applications. Yeah. Next is like intercepting the app server communication. So like when the application is interacting with the iPhone, you can intercept that communication. So for intercepting that communication, we can use proxy method. You need to set up a bob suit. So basically someone who has a knowledge of bob suit and server and all, they could relate to this. Otherwise it's like bit difficult for you all to understand. So like first you need to understand what is the IP address of the system. So for this you need to have a system and the device the same network for trying this thing. System and device should be in the same network. Otherwise, it won't be possible for you to intercept. So, like, you need to find the IP address of the system and then go ahead. And then in the mobile device, you have to set up a proxy. So once you set up a proxy in your mobile device with the given IP of your MacBook or the desktop, whatever you are using, then you have to set up a proxy and you have to set up the port. And once that is done, you have to make the configuration manual in this way, like the whatever I'm saying, the server and port you have to give, and then you have to set up these things, and then you have to allow bob suit certificate to be trusted to the application. So once it's trusted, you can intercept the request in your application. Yeah. So see, like once you are done with this option settings and all, yeah. So like see this is the iPhone application. So I've entered some CVV details, and when I click on OK, I am able to intercept that on a desktop machine or above a MacBook. So I am able to see that communication. So like for disabling this, you need to have a SSL pinning thing or a certificate pinning thing you need in place. So if the pinning is done, then you cannot intercept the application. So in this case, the application is running on HTTP. So you can even on HTTPS also you can try to like intercept unless and until certificate pinning. So it is a different concept, SSL pinning. If that is X509 certificate is taken at runtime, then only it's possible to not possible easily to intercept or do man of the middle attack. Reverse engineering. Yeah. So reverse engineering basically refers to like what is like refer what happens is the code the application when it is running, when it gets installed on your device, there is some code running in backend. So some code gets installed on your device. So there is a code in like assembly language in the C format or the based on the development framework, the code is developed and it gets run. So what happens is sometimes while developing developer hard code sensitive information into the code. So it's recommended not to hard code any sensitive information into the application code. So how you need to check this? So we can check using a tool called Hopper Deassembler. This tool will help you to analyze the code, but you need to be a bit like able to analyze source code. So once this, you open this tool, then you can select the IPA file, and then you can open it based on the So you have to select the executable first. What you have to do is convert the IPA to .zip file. Change the like file type from .ipa to .zip. Once that it is done, you can once it's converted to zip, then you have get a payload folder. In that payload folder, you will get a binary file. So basically, you have to select that binary file and analyze in the Hopper tool. See, this iGoat is the binary file. Inside the payload folder, there will be a binary file. So you have to analyze that binary file. And once you analyze that binary file, you can see the details. Like the answer for the query is visible in the code. So it's recommended to avoid storing sensitive information hard-coded in the hard coding this information in the code. So this kind of thing should be avoided by a developer. There are other ways to check this thing. Even you can use a strings method like this commands. You can through terminal also you can try using the strings command and all. You can grep and do these things. If you are good with Linux, you can try manually using the command cmd terminal. So in checking for insufficient cryptography. So these are basically the over top 10 things. So like the cryptographic algorithms that are out of date or the it's a bit easy to retrieve password if it's MD5 based. So it's basically recommended not to use MD5 and all. So you can check the what kind of algorithms are there. For that you need to like unzip and analyze the application. So here we can see the application using algorithm SHA-1. So it's we can analyze this using a tool called OTool. Other than that, there is a one more tool, Radari2. So you need to set up these tools and then you can analyze the IPA file after unzipping and all. You need to be like understand all this, but it's a bit complex. I think it's in this time to understand. So you need to be dedicatedly working on this, then you can like bit familiar with this insecure authorization. So what happens is, like when you log in into an application, there are different roles like normal user, admin user and all. So like a normal user cannot access the admin's part, but in some cases what happens is there is a like vulnerability, like the development is not properly done, or there is like a flaw in the way the development is done. So like what happens is, like there is a profile page. So a normal user can check the profile page in normal case. So see this, this is one of the demo applications I'm showing. So what happens is, this is a normal user. He is able to see his role. His role is a delivery man role. But what I will do, I will intercept this communication at runtime using the Burpsuit tool. And what we do is we change the ID for understanding, like here his ID is 408. So I manipulate and change that ID to 407 or 402. In this case, I have done from 408 to 402. And when I send the request ahead, see, I am able to view details of the another delivery, another person. That is not the delivery man. That was the profile of some another person we are able to view. So basically, it refers to insecure direct object reference or authorization bypass. So in a normal application, authorization bypass should not be there. So this kind of vulnerabilities are to be analyzed during dynamic analysis. Okay, yeah, this is the end. Thank you. Any questions, you can let me know.
Danish?
Yes, sir.
Danish, are you done the session?
Yes, sir. I have completed, sir. Yes, sir, I have done the session. I am building.